anywhere migraine medicine.
How do we decide what hotel to book? Fear not.
I got you. Choice Hotels has a hotel for every type of stay.
Like a comfort with the kiddos.
Spacious.
That's what they all say. Stay twice and get a $50 gift card when you book direct at choicehotels.com.
What are they doing here?
I don't know. AC is acting funny.
It seems like everything's fine with the air conditioning. Is anybody messing with the temperature? Are you 64? Doc out.
From the station that's on your side, this is News 12 at 6 o'clock.
A CrossFit gym is packing up after a molestation scandal on their property involving the owner.
And after a four-year-old lost his life during a swim lesson, Governor Kemp taking steps to make sure no other family has to suffer like that.
But first, the suspect accused of murdering 13-year-old Bunny Brown is in custody. U.S. Marshals arrested him hundreds of miles away in central Pennsylvania. 13 days ago, we told you they were looking for Gregory Thornton up in the Northeast.
That shooting actually happened in downtown Augusta at the Richmond Summit Apartments. Police say Thornton was staying here in Augusta when the murder happened. Thornton then ran away to Baltimore, and the FBI and U.S. Marshals Service were going to serve a warrant last month at his apartment just outside Baltimore when he ran and led police on a high-speed chase up there. The U.S. Marshals Service says they found him east of Chambersburg, Pennsylvania, just north of Maryland.
A gunman snatched Buddy's life away when he stepped outside of his apartment building in downtown Augusta late one night to grab a DoorDash order. His friends and family told us he loved being around his family, he was protective, and had an infectious smile.
And for Buddy's family, today's arrest is a small step towards justice. Our Hallie Turner spoke with the family just hours ago, and Hallie, I'm sure this has been an emotional day for them.
Yeah, the news comes with a wave of emotions because it wasn't from law enforcement that told Buddy's family that Thornton is behind bars. They say they haven't heard from them in months. It was News 12 who gave Anita a call.
After 6 weeks, Buddy Brown's family finally received the call they have been waiting on from News 12 reporter Will Rio.
Oh, I'm so happy. I told him, I said, God bless you and thank you. He really been working for the family.
The U.S. Marshals Service says they found Buddy's killer east of Chambersburg, Pennsylvania. But Buddy's grandmother says she never got a call from law enforcement about it.
Like they didn't kill nobody.
She says she hasn't heard a word from Richmond County investigators in weeks.
The last time you talked to Richmond County was when?
3 days, 4 days after Buddy had got murdered, and I haven't heard anything then.
No answers about his killer led to constant worry.
I'm up half of the night looking at the window, seeing if anybody gonna come and break in the house. Worry about my grandchildren, worry about my daughters, worry about my son, my grandson. You know, I was just scared for our life. I really was.
Unfortunately, it's a fear that's gripped her before. 23 years ago, her son, Buddy's uncle Derek, was murdered in Burke County.
It brings back a lot of memories. Like it just had me choked up inside, and I said, Lord, please don't let me die, but I thought I was going to have a heart attack. I really was.
She says she knows her grandson left this place trying to protect those around him.
Got a feeling now. I believe Buddy was trying to protect everybody. He was trying to fight with Thornton.
The U.S. Marshals Service tells us Thornton will be extradited back here to Georgia to face murder charges.
Hopefully one step towards closure for this family. Thanks for that, Hallie. Taking a look outside today, pretty nice, another breezy day.
Another really windy day, but Riley, you say that wind is finally coming to an end.
Finally going to calm down for us. Heading into tonight and over the next couple of days, a significant drop in those wind speeds. And we will continue to see cooler than average temperatures, though, at least through Friday afternoon. We were seeing just about 10 minutes.
A CrossFit gym is packing up after deputies arrested one of its owners for molestation. The victim, just 15 years old, had been training at the gym.
All of this coming to light after his wife turned him into authorities. Our Nick Veland is live on Oak Drive. So what else have you learned about this investigation, Nick?
Yeah, Laura, well, a moving truck came by earlier today to start packing up some things, and some business neighbors tell us that the gym has been quiet since Monday. No really classes have been taking place, and they started packing up the gym starting yesterday, and that's all when the news broke of this CrossFit coach. Doors open to being shut and finally driving away. All after
after deputies arrested the owner of Bear CrossFit and charged him with molestation on Monday. Bags are looking like they're being packed and equipment is being disassembled. The sign says CrossFit for everyone, but that was the gym's name before Scott Page bought it and took it over in December. The new name is Bear CrossFit, but the doors weren't even open long enough for them to change the sign. The police report says Scott's wife, Lauren, turned Scott in after coming home on Monday and catching Scott with a 15-year-old who went to the gym where Scott coached. According to the report, the first sign started in January when Lauren says she wanted to give Scott another chance and says that Scott didn't want to go to jail. We reached out to the Columbia County Sheriff's Office to see if staying quiet until now could mean charges for his wife, but the Sheriff's Office says she's not facing charges. Owners of other CrossFit gyms are worried that this could hurt their businesses too and give CrossFit a bad name, but they want to make sure that everyone knows CrossFit gyms are independently run. They are not connected with Scott's gym. All you have to do is pay an affiliation fee to be a CrossFit gym.
And the other businesses in this area say that it has been a lot quieter since Monday, and the foot traffic has lessened because they're used to this CrossFit gym bringing in foot traffic throughout multiple times throughout the day. And we'll continue to follow this case and keep you updated every step of the way.
All right, Nick, thanks for that. 11 months after the tragic drowning of 4-year-old Izzy Scott, today Governor Brian Kemp signing a new bill that creates safety guidelines for private swim lessons and teachers. Izzy Scott's family lost him to a drowning last year during his second swimming lesson.
State House reporter Abby Casares talked with the Scotts and a swim instructor about what they think should be included in the plan.
Israel Scott dreamed of superheroes. Now he has become one. No one in the state may have quite an impact on aquatic safety than the 4-year-old.
I still feel like he's still living somewhere, you know?
For Dory Watson, Izzy's mother, this moment means other mothers won't have to feel her pain.
I know it's a bittersweet day.
Less than a year ago, her 4-year-old son, Izzy, drowned while at a private swimming lesson.
We're still looking at pictures every day, videos every day.
The instructor who was giving the lesson when Scott drowned, Lexi Tennyson, was charged with involuntary manslaughter.
You shouldn't have to worry about, you know, something like this happening to your child.
In photos, Izzy's always playing in the water or wearing a superhero mask and a cape.
And he loves superheroes, so like I kind of look at it like, you know, he's being a superhero to all the kids that love water, that want to take swim, and just make it safe for them.
Senate Bill 107, or Izzy's Law, requires the Department of Public Health to add a safety plan for private instructors. Right now, there is none. Senator Max Burns says it fixes a major gap in Georgia law.
No other person in our state and probably our nation will have the impact on aquatic safety that Israel Scott is having and will continue to have. So
the Department of Public Health is currently coming up with that safety plan. They have until July 1st when the bill goes into effect. Izzy's family says they'd like to see another instructor present, as well as greater ratios between students and instructors. In Atlanta, I'm Abby Casores.
And Izzy's Law will require that student-to-instructor ratio she mentioned, the presence of that secondary instructor, just to make sure the safety of all those swimmers, and allowing all parents and guardians to be right there present at private swim lessons.
All new at 6 o'clock, we're getting an inside look at the terms of the WellStar-AU Health merger. The name WellStar may sound familiar to you. WellStar's Atlanta Medical Center was one of the few Level 1 trauma centers in Georgia before they suddenly closed the doors. After the closure, Augusta University Medical Center became one of only 4 Level 1 trauma centers in the entire state. WellStar will become the sole corporate member of AU Health. They'll spend nearly $800 million with the deal over the next 10 years. Millions of those dollars will be used to build the new Columbia County Hospital and move the current surgery center. $200 million will be used for the AU Medical Center campus. They'll also switch over to the new state electronic health record system. In the master affiliation agreement, WellStar has a 40-year contract with the University System of Georgia, the Board of Regents. That's who oversees AU Health System. In the first 10 years of the deal, if WellStar tries to sell or transfer its stake in the Medical College of Georgia, the Board of Regents can give a right of first refusal, meaning they get the first chance to acquire all of those assets before they offer them to someone else. AU Health has lost $63 million overall since 2017, according to audits, but they've been looking for a partner since 2019. So this deal looks like it will help AU recover some of those money losses.
Still ahead, the run for the roses just days away now, but what does it really take to create a winning horse? We head to Aiken to find out. They should know.
And we have seen a dry and breezy start to the week. Moving forward, we're calming those winds down, but bringing back some rain chances by the weekend. We'll have that full forecast just after break. For us, should be beautiful to get outside. Hanging on to that dry weather through our Friday afternoon, but into the weekend, just make sure you have that First Alert weather app downloaded to keep an eye on those rain chances.
Okay, time to dust off your hats and get those mint juleps ready. We're 3 days away from the Kentucky Derby. Churchill Downs is wrapping up their final preps. Millions tune in every year for the race. Closer to home, eyes are on that Derby trophy. The Derby is the longest running sporting event, and the field is limited to only 20 horses, so the cut is very tough.
It really is. Alyssa Lyons spoke with our longtime trainer Ed Aiken about what it takes to win that coveted blanket of roses.
The Kentucky Derby is the greatest 2 minutes in sports, and while it's short, it is the pinnacle of so many trainers' career. Imagine getting to reach that moment 8 times over.
This one's daddy did run in the Kentucky Derby. The hands are old, I'm a little slower, but I'm still here.
Ron Stevens was never planning to be here.
I got a degree in education, thinking I could have the summers to play with the horses, and I started racing some of the horses. Sorry, you can finish your lunch in a minute. I quit my teaching job. My wife quit a good government job. We went to the racetrack. All right, big boy.
He turned a hobby into a life.
It would be my job to try and decide which horses might be Derby candidates and need to go to the top trainers at the top tracks and which ones need to go somewhere where they could just make a living. The thing that really got us going was Swabby Summer Squall. He was an undefeated 2-year-old. He should have and could have won the Derby, and he competed against Unbridled, and we ran 6 times against him and beat him 4 times.
Me in the red jacket and my wife in the white there.
When he went to the front coming out of the turn and 100,000 screaming people got his attention, he looked at him and Unbridled went by him and he couldn't get going again and win it.
There was Willenda, Smiling, Singing Sam, Jack Flash.
The town would wear green and yellow on the Derby day that we were running one of these horses.
Impeachment, Trippy, Limehouse, and Palace Malice.
We would be replaced with computers if they could figure out how big the heart is, how big much try they have, how determined they're going to be.
Almost as determined as their trainer.
We've won the Preakness and the Belmont, but we have not won the Derby yet. We say yet because it's always a dream.
And Aiken, Alyssa Lyons on her side.
Breaking news, we now know the name of the victim involved in a deadly crash. The Richmond County Coroner's Office tells us 36-year-old Garrett Stroud was hit by a car near 14, they were telling us.
Richmond County deputies tell us it happened around 3:30 in the morning, so this is a very early crash. Stroud pronounced dead just after 5 o'clock this morning. We're back with more News 12 at 6 o'clock.
First Alert Radar. All Clarendon clear.
Wherever I go, I'm always keeping an eye on the power lines. In my home of Puerto Rico, Hurricane Maria showed us what can happen with a weak and outdated power grid. So I became an electrical engineer, and now I work for Georgia Power. We're investing in the latest secure technologies, and we're building the future of energy today. Our customers are counting on us for a modern and dependable power grid. And I'll be keeping an eye out to make sure they get it.
Insurance company Bonvoy and Associates.
Earlier this year, the Georgia Cancer Center started its mobile lab program. It brings science to students.
Now some students from A.R. Johnson Magnet School are learning more about cancer and how it develops. Will Volk stop by to learn more.
Students are putting on their lab coats because the lab is coming to them.
We have all this equipment that we bring with us. Schools don't usually have this kind of equipment. It's the same kinds of things that we use in our research labs over at the Cancer Center.
Rhea Beth Markowitz says the Georgia Cancer Center plans to bring its new mobile lab to classrooms across the area.
We don't have some of this equipment here at the school, so it introduces them to things like that.
Healthcare science teacher Brandi Harris says the Cancer Center offered to bring its lab to her class.
We're going to do a test.
A.R. Johnson is one of the first schools in our area to experience this.
We love bringing in folks from the community and providing these activities for our kids to enhance their learning.
It is such a pipette.
Markowitz wants students to fall in love with this career field. She says they don't even have to leave town to pursue it.
They could spend their whole careers here in Augusta if they want.
Today, students are working with real samples in the mobile lab.
They're getting a hands-on research experience.
And Markowitz hopes one day they'll be doing the same thing in the real lab. In Augusta, we'll vote on your side.
Just a great learning experience for those students. Cool. The Georgia Cancer Center plans to bring that mobile lab to one or two schools a month starting next school year.
Very hands-on. Neat.
On your sideline, sports brought to you by the Hawk Law Group.
In less than 24 hours, the Greenbrier girls soccer team will write the final chapter of their storybook season by playing in the Class 5A state championship game. With one more game left to be played, the Wolfpack are 19-0, knocking on the door of perfection. A catalyst to this unbeaten campaign is Greenbrier's lockdown defense and the chemistry this team has built from the experience of playing together for years. Having 15 shutouts on the season says a great deal about how much pressure the Wolfpack can put on their opponents, and this team says they prepared all year for this moment, and right now it's all about going out there, doing their jobs, and playing their game.
This is probably the craziest game that I played in. I played soccer for a long time, probably 12 to 13 years, but this is the first time we've ever made it to a state championship, so it's extremely exciting, and we're feeling confident, but you know, it's also, we have to get prepared, we have to be there, and you know, you have to keep your nerves down.
I'll have live coverage of the Class 5A state championship game between the Greenbrier Wolfpack and the Chamblee Lady Bulldogs from Duluth High School tomorrow. The match begins at 5 o'clock. The Augusta Green Jackets are on the road for a six-game series against the Kannapolis Cannonballers. These two minor league ball clubs had an early start today, and the Jackets got the job done 4-1. This is Augusta's second consecutive win in this series. The Green Jackets will be back in town on Tuesday when they take on the Charleston River Dogs.
All right, thanks for that, Dan. If you have any evening plans, skies are staying clear and temperatures are dropping off quickly once we get past sunset. Then look at that forecast for you just after the break.